So we got this 63 Nova, and it's one of our camera guys who kind of comes around every now and then to shoot with us, and he bought it. It's his first time ever owning any type of hot rod, and like a lot of people, you know, you're on a budget. So he started out with a four-door, which this is, and well, we're gonna throw some stuff at it. We're just not sure what we need to throw at it yet. This is my first time taking it for a ride. I kind of looked underneath. One thing I noticed right off the bat, there is zero power steering. So the power steering assist lines have been cut, which is pretty common on these cars just because of, well, it really wasn't the best design power steering out there. From here, we're gonna test out the brakes, the steering, just see how it overall handles. That way we can kind of go down and make a playlist on what we want to do to this car and kind of show you guys step by step on what we're doing and why. So we'll call this guy Austin, who owns the car, because that's his name. He brought this car and said, man, I got a pretty nice car, runs really good, it actually drives nice. And first thing I notice, it doesn't drive nice. So I don't know if he hauls himself around on a donkey and this is his first type of gasoline transportation, and it may very well be. But one thing I noticed, this thing's got so much slop in the steering. And again, we'll put this thing up on the lift and see what our real problems are. But we're gonna come up to our first stop sign and let's give the brakes a shot. Actually, the brakes aren't half bad. So that's a good sign so far. I'll take back a little bit what I said about Austin, and the brakes do work pretty comfortable with them, but the steering's completely shot, so much slop, and these cars are notorious for so much roll in them. I mean, you can hear the tires skidding, we're not even moving that fast. Yeah, so that's fun. To me, they're probably one of the most poorly designed, engineered suspensions out there for this era. I think we got some things to work on. We're gonna get it back to the shop. It's getting a little late in the day today, but tomorrow come in and kind of go through the car and see exactly what we wanna do and what parts we wanna throw at it and kind of do a step-by-step and show you guys on what we're doing and why we're doing it. So that being said, we'll see you guys tomorrow. And that's where you fade off into the sunset. So after taking the car around the block a few times, we obviously noticed some issues that we just didn't like. Poor ride quality, car kind of wandered, bunch of slop in the steering wheel. So now that the car's up on the lift, we kind of check these things out. And one thing I noticed is a bunch of slop in this idler arm. Both of the tie rods are worn out. In fact, all the bushings are worn out. The car's 60 years old. It doesn't look like much has been changed on it. And that poor ride quality is probably coming from a worn out shock and spring. So definitely gonna change all that stuff out. And I did kind of touch base a little bit on the power steering and why it wasn't working. And that would be because the power steering lines were cut for the assist ram. So, well, we want this car to function and kind of steer and brake like a newer car. So I think the best option for us is gonna go with CPP's mini subframe kit. And that will give us all that good geometry we're looking for, a quality ride. One thing we are gonna do is stick with these brakes because it has been upgraded to disc brakes, and that's why the car did stop pretty good. So maybe we'll turn the rotors, put some new friction on there, but outside of that, we'll leave the brakes alone. So, well, it's only one thing left for me to do, and that, well, I guess get to work. Now we got the new parts out here on the table. This is CPP's mini subframe deluxe kit with sway bars and all steering linkage. And next to me is Danny, and he's gonna kind of walk us through and explain, you know, some of the parts, starting with the mini subframe kit.
It consists of a new cross member to replace the strut rod mounts that were on the chassis and a tubular A-arm. It's got a lot of ground clearance advantages. This is a lot shorter than the whole strut rod mechanism, which is really pretty big.
Sure.
So this is way smaller and tighter.
Yeah, so, you know, with the subframe kit, it will rigid up the front of the car because it is a quarter inch plate and it's tying in both basically what I would call a frame rail, but the subframe itself. Another advantage is it's giving us another place to align. But what I really want to talk about is why the strut rods were so bad to begin with.
So the whole mechanism was really in a bind. So in order to move during a bump suspension movement, it had to bend and flex and twist. So they're flimsy for that reason. So they don't break, they have to flex and bend. And the whole time it's doing that, it's really changing the caster on the wheel alignment. When you hit the brakes hard, it goes back. When you're off the brakes, they kind of go forward in a turn. They kind of go forward and back and wiggle around.
Yeah.
And what that really translates to as the person driving is you're just sawing back and forth on the wheel, trying to hold your line or go straight. They just drive horrible.
Poor design, for sure.
Yeah.
So like I said, this does add another point that you can align the car.
Yeah, so the caster is primarily adjusted up at the front on the new mount that we're going to install. It uses the same alignment cams that's in the factory mounting position, which will be towards the rear of the car, and that's going to do your camber change.
Awesome. And so here's your cam, or these are your cams here, and then we got these little plates here. What do they do?
So these are our lockout plates. Essentially, what you would do is align the car with the cams, makes it pretty easy to get the alignment done. After the alignment is set, you can line up the cams in their different mounting positions. You notice the offset holes, and find the position that aligns with where your bolt is. Mark that position, take out the alignment cam, put the lockout plates in and tighten it all back down. And when it's done, the alignment cannot move. So if you were gonna drive the car hard on the track and you're diving into a corner and you hit the apex and you're bouncing off the curb, there's a chance that the alignment cams would slide.
Sure.
Because if they don't really lock as positive, the lockout plates removes all that possibility. They're a lockdown solid.
So that's just an added feature you guys supply with the kit.
Yeah, it comes standard with every kit. Every mini subframe is gonna have a set of lockout plates.
It's awesome. You know, sticking with the suspension right now, let's go to the upper control arms. Is there anything different with the upper control arm than a stock one?
So to start with, it's a tubular A arm. It's way stronger, much more rigid, less flexing and bending happening than the original sheet metal arm ever was. Number two, it's a quarter inch shorter on each side of the car. The idea is you could pull the wheels in that extra quarter inch. A lot of times these cars, especially the earlier models, 6.2 to 6.5, the tires rub the outer fender. So that quarter inch is huge. Also, if you're adding power steering, you might want to add a lot more caster into the car, and you could just shim the upper A-arm out like it was, say, a Camaro or a Chevelle, the standard alignment shims. It's really kind of a no-brainer idea when you think about
sure.
it. It's a simple, smart way to put the car together.
Absolutely. So you referenced power steering. And we got a couple steering components up here from a center link to tie rods. Let's talk about the center link and everything that ties into it.
Right, so this is our center link. It's part of the whole linkage kit. But in the case of this car specifically, it had power-assisted steering, which means that the steering linkage actually had a control valve attached to one end or the pitman arm attached, and there's a shuttle valve in there. And if you're not running that power-assisted steering, and I don't recommend using it, it doesn't work that well, you have kind of a play in the steering system, because when you're steering the car, the first thing you're doing is actually moving the control valve left or right before anything else
sure.
steers. So you end up with like a big dead spot in play. They just don't drive that well anyway.
Well, basically, you're using a manual box and then putting an assist on there to run the manual box to feel like power steering. It's not even a power steering box.
Right, yeah, so you still have the slow ratio.
Right.
You have all that play in there. This is a way nicer setup on this car.
Yeah.
And if you happen to have one, nice thing is it's gonna come assembled. It's got the new bushings in here. It's part of the whole linkage kit. So really, for the price of just buying the tie rods that might be worn out, you could just buy the whole kit.
Absolutely. And you know, talking about the power steering, we're probably gonna upgrade this car to an actual box. You guys have a box for this car, and why not? We're here, we're into the front end, we're doing all the suspensions, so we might as well add that power steering box. But now moving over to a sway bar, you guys have had sway bars for these cars forever, but we're using your guys' all new high clearance sway bar. And high clearance, what's all that mean?
So we have a whole line of high clearance bars. This is the one for the Nova, where we pulled that in as far as possible to give you a lot more room running a larger tire and not cutting down the turning radius. At the same time, it's lightweight, it's a hollow bar. It's got adjustable mounting positions. It uses a rod end up on the top and then a conventional bushing that goes down into the lower A-arm. It'll work with the stock control arms. It'll work with our tubular arms.
Very good.
And the whole thing, it's really rigid. It's a really stiff, larger diameter sway bar. When it's all done, it's really geared up for some high-performance driving.
Sure. Awesome. So we got a set of stock springs out here. You guys also have lowering springs, which I think we're going to use in this.
Yeah, the car came in kind of low, so yep. I think lowering springs is the better choice.
No, I'm sure that we're going to get questions. We might as well answer it now. Will this all work with a coilover setup?
So yeah, we could switch to coilover. There's really no change in anything other than just changing the spring and shock.
That's awesome. And last two components on the table is the top portion for the spring and then the purchase.
Right, so new spring purchase. A lot of times people don't consider the fact that this is a wear item on their car. All the way to the front of the car is sitting on the spring, is sitting on this rubber bushing, and it wears out. It has to pivot over every bump, every turn, every time the suspension moves. This is moving, but it should be replaced. And when you're tearing it down like this, it's the right time to do it.
Yeah. And all these parts on the table are going to make this car drive, I mean, night and day differently, you know, from steering and just the ride quality itself.
Yeah, so ride quality is going to be nice. The steering and the drivability of the car, huge, huge difference.
Yeah. And you got to remember, these cars were built 60 years ago, and this was kind of GM's entry-level car. Maybe most homes would have it as a secondary car, maybe $2,200 brand new. So, you know, there weren't a whole lot of expenses used to really make it a performance car. This is a secondary car. Well, get to the store and back.
Absolutely an economy car, and it drove every bit like an economy car.
So I'm excited. I can get the car up on the lift, get the parts off the table and onto the car, and maybe get it back on the road. That wraps up this video. If you want to see more on this car, as far as suspension, brakes, and steering, click the links below. When you're ready for your high-quality parts, visit classicperform.com or give us a call.